now. Okay. All right. So thank you for joining us for today's skill sharing conversation. We're so happy to have you here. Today's topic is free and inexpensive marketing tools, presented by Carina Gonzalez of the Piscataway Public Library. Just a little bit about Carina before we get started. Carina Gonzalez, she/her, is a senior adult services librarian with the Piscataway Public Library. Her passions in librarianship include social justice, access, and intellectual freedom. She began her career as an elementary library media specialist, followed by being a high school library media specialist, and then went on to become an outreach academic librarian before finally finding her home in public librarianship. Carina is an accomplished writer, professional web designer, and entrepreneur, and we are thrilled to have her here with us today. Thank you, Carina, for being here, and I will let you take it away now.
Cool. All right. Let me share my screen. Thank you for the lovely intro, Darby. All right. Let's see. Okay. Here we are. Can everybody see that? Yes. Okay. Excellent. So hello. And welcome to Free and Inexpensive Marketing Tools. It is possible to market your library's programs and services using no money at all, or very little money. In this presentation, you will learn free online tools, networking tips, social media basics, and design tricks. Bring your challenges and ideas, and we'll brainstorm solutions together. So as Darby said, my name is Carina Gonzalez. I'm a senior adult services librarian at the Piscataway Public Library. If you need to contact me, you can do so here on that slide, cgonzalez@piscatawaylibrary.org. Feel free to drop questions in the chat and I'll get to them as I can, though I can't see the chat. So Darby, if you could tell me
if
people have questions.
I will keep an eye on the chat for you.
Okay, thank you. So here's the plan, which it's totally okay if we derail. The plan is to start with design tricks, then go on to social media basics. Then we may or may not pause for breakout rooms so we can talk a little bit more about what we've learned and share some ideas. I'll pause at that point and ask you again if you wanna do that. And then we'll go on to online tools and networking tips. So let's start with design tricks. Here are some concepts to keep in mind as you design your marketing materials. So here are the general ideas, and then we'll go through each of them point by point. The first is that good artists copy, great artists steal. You may have heard that phrase before. Legibility is queen, ADA compliance, pics and pixels, fonts, know your hexes, and make your designs palatable. So let's start with great artists steal. First, Picasso is credited with saying good artists copy, great artists steal. However, whether or not he said that is an unsubstantiated claim. In other words, he stole it. So what that saying means is that all artists are inspired by each other and borrow each other's ideas, but truly great designs steal them into something unique and memorable. Never try to invent what has already been created. See what's already out there. Get ideas from others. Use templates, Frankenstein your creations. The more you emulate good design, the better you'll understand it and make it your own. Legibility is queen. We are trying to get across a message when we're trying to market. If the words in your design are difficult to read, it has failed in its mission. Sorry. I will often work in a design, think it's aesthetically gorgeous, love the colors and play of the shapes, and then realize no one is going to be able to read this. So as you can see by this image, it's pretty clear which one is the most legible, both by the colors and by the fonts. In short, lovely isn't as important as legible. Which brings me right over to ADA compliance. Every message you create should ideally be ADA compliant. ADA stands for the Americans with Disabilities Act. You don't know which patrons are using screen readers, are colorblind or a host of any other vision challenges. An easy way to do this is uploading your completed design or whatever step you are in the process to an ADA image compliance scanner. I put a free one in the resources list. It will tell you on a scale of 1 to 10 if your image is ADA compliant. Ideally, you want to shoot for a score of higher than 7. The first page of this presentation got a score of 9.35. Pics and pixels. Whenever you take an image and put it into a design, you can make the image smaller, but never make it bigger. Every image on a computer is made of tiny dots called pixels. Dragging a picture to fill a space pixelates it, which means it looks fuzzy because it increases the space between those dots of color. You're better off getting a larger image in the first place, so you don't have to worry about that problem. So for example, here we have a beautiful standard poodle, which happens to be my favorite breed of dog. Don't yuck my yum. The original size looks crisp, but it's too small for the space that we're designing, right? So if I drag it until its size is where I want it to be, now the poodle went from looking fluffy to frayed. Fortunately, most sites that provide free images give you a selection of larger sizes to choose from. And if you use Google Advanced Image Search, which I included in the resources at the end of this presentation, you can filter for size, color, transparency, usage rights, as well as size. There are file formats such as vector images that allow you to change size without pixelation. And you need to be wary of images that are so big that they're difficult to render on a slower computer. But this is the basics. So the basics is the general rule is you do not want to make images bigger. Let's talk about fonts. Many organizations have an institutional font that is their official font. Find out what it is and know when to use it in your designs. This will help all designs coming out of your organization look like part of a visual family. This doesn't mean you can't use other fonts, but you should know what the official one is and how often it is appropriate for you to use other ones. Some organizations even have style guides that really spell out fonts, colors, logo use, and required boilerplate language. Your institution's style guide is something you should know inside and out before you design a thing for your organization. If you would like to use other fonts, generally try to only use 2 different fonts per design. There are ways to use multiple fonts as well, but that's more of an advanced skill, and it's easier to do it wrong than to do it right. One great tool I use to help me with font pairings is called FontJoy. FontJoy is a website where you can generate font pairings. You literally just click the button generate and it'll just keep giving you different pairings. And then you can lock one. So if you say, I like the top one, but not the bottom one, you can lock the top one and then keep hitting generate and it'll just keep giving you other ones. And if they present a font that you don't have, it gives you a link right there so that you can download it. If you need help downloading and uploading fonts, let me know, because that is a bit too hard to explain in this presentation. Knowing about fonts, the whole world of fonts is called typography. And that is a presentation in and of itself. It is an entire art, an entire world, and I'm a total nerd for it. Know your hexes. Computers see colors as alphanumeric 6-digit.
All right.
Okay.
Richardson Public Library, how can I help you?
All right. Computers see colors as alphanumeric 6-digit codes known as hexadecimals or hex colors for short. Every color on your computer has a corresponding hex color. For example, the light blue in the upper right-hand corner of this presentation is actually 6AB8CB. Your organization probably has official colors, and there are hexadecimal codes that match them. Someone in your organization probably knows what they are, but you can always use my favorite Chrome extension, which is called Eyedropper. Eyedropper is what you can use to find out the colors that are on your screen. The link is in the resources at the end of the presentation, and it allows you to hover over any area of the screen with your cursor and it will tell you what hex color that spot is. So in the lower right corner of your screen, it'll change and show the hex colors as you drag it along. It's really cool, super useful, especially for implementing your organization's colors or just matching elements in your design. So maybe you have a beautiful, colorful picture and you want your words to match the blue that is in the background of something or other. So you can figure out what exactly that blue is and then change your fonts to match. I probably use Eyedropper every day. This might be my favorite.
And Carina, I would guess you're gonna get to this soon, but someone in the chat said that they use Canva for a lot of these.
Tools.
So I'm sure we're gonna talk about Canva, but.
Oh yeah, Canva's definitely a fave.
That just came.
But please keep those ideas coming because these are my favorites. There's a lot more out there than what I'm talking about. So spam that chat with ideas and we'll, you know, make sure they're shared out to everybody. And hopefully I'll learn something new too. So palatable designs. Just like you compare fonts, you compare colors. And there are websites out there to help you find just the right palette for your project, just like you're going to decorate a room or you're going to paint or something like that. I like to use Coolors. That's its name, Coolors. They just redid their website and you can randomly generate palettes. So you see that blue start the generator button. You just hit that and it'll just keep giving you random palettes. And just like with FontJoy, you can lock one of the colors and have the others rotate. So maybe you have a design color that matches your organizational color. It's a maroon and you want to know another highlight color that will go well with the maroon. So you can pop it into Coolors, and then you can come up with some cool pairings. And of course, the link is in the resources slide at the end. All right, let's talk about, got a question?
Sorry, somebody just said Coolors tool is especially useful for the colorblind.
Yes.
For folks to keep in mind.
Thank you, yes, excellent point. All right, now we're going to talk about social media basics.
Oh, sorry, you have a question.
Okay, go ahead.
Natalie says, are RGB colors similar to hex colors?
RGB is a different language. So just think of it as French and Spanish. So every single color also has an RGB component. Eyedropper, which is the tool that I use, does also show you the RGB as well as the hexadecimal. And if you ever use a tool that doesn't, there are free tools online that you can just Google that will transfer one to the other. Because sometimes they'll use tools that just don't have hexadecimals in them. They only take RGB. So I have to go online, plug in the hexadecimal and tell me what the conversion is. It's like metric. So I can find out what the RGB equivalent is. So it's the same thing, just a different language. Okay, we good? Okay, social media basics. I put social media on its own because it really does deserve its own show. Social media has forever changed marketing, whether we like it or not. And here are some basics to keep in mind. Remember that social media is 2.0, as in two-way street, as in takes two to tango. It requires conversation. If you are using your social media only as a means of spreading information, you are missing a huge opportunity to engage your community. Ask questions, give opinions, run contests, anything that looks more like a discussion and less like a bulletin board. Number two, know your demographics. Not all social media are created equal, especially when it comes to the demographics that use them. But don't just take my word for it. According to the Pew Research Center's social media fact sheet, which they posted this year, men are more likely to use Facebook than Instagram. YouTube is actually the most popular social media platform, not Facebook. People over the age of 30 use Facebook over Instagram. Hispanics use Snapchat more than Twitter. And don't forget about Pinterest, LinkedIn, WhatsApp, Reddit, TikTok, and Nextdoor, all of which have at least 27 million active monthly users. So know your demographic. That Pew Research fact sheet is really useful and it's interactive. So you can click on different tabs and really find out the data that you need and figure out which social media is the best for you. Because number three, don't take on too much. Because it's tempting to join all those platforms to maximize your reach, especially if you find out that your name is available everywhere. You want to just snatch them up so nobody takes them away from you. It's better to pick one social media platform and do it well than to have 11 and do them all poorly. Make sure you have enough content, people power, and tech savvy to dive into social media. You'll be happy you did, especially if you do a little planning ahead of time. Oh, number four, link accounts if you want to. One way you can ease the burden of juggling multiple social media accounts is by linking the accounts together. This means whatever you post on one platform will automatically be shared on another. Ideally, pie in the sky, you would use each different platform for a different reason, and this would encourage people to join both. But for the busy marketer, linking accounts is a lifesaver. This is easy with Facebook and Instagram, since they're both owned by the same company, Meta. But if you have two platforms that don't have built-in methods to link in, to link them, I recommend using IFTTT, which stands for If This, Then That. IFTTT lets you create all kinds of amazing workflows that go far beyond social media. IFTTT is another one of those tools that can be a presentation by itself. I recommend checking them out and playing around. The link is in the resources. IFTTT is also one of those things where you do the slight learning curve, you learn how to use what they call recipes, you put these recipes together and they just run in the background. You don't have to visit them unless you change an account or something weird happens. I've had some IFTTT recipes that run for years. For example, my Twitter account will automatically say Happy New Year, even though I'm probably asleep when the ball drops because I have children. All right, number five, have a schedule. Whether you link them or not, I recommend having a schedule. I called mine the tweet sheet. You don't have to be on social media 24/7 to make it useful. A couple times a week is enough to do the trick. And programs like Hootsuite allow you to schedule postings for different social media programs ahead of time, meaning you can sit down and plan out your posts one day during the week, and then they'll all show up whenever you want them to. You don't have to actually have to be there and press the post button at the time you want it to go live. When you approach social media as a project rather than something you just react to, it makes it much easier to handle. Number six, assign oversight. It doesn't work when a large group of people collectively use a social media platform. Everyone thinks the other's already posted. You'll have different styles of communication, different tones, and it results in a confusing message. There needs to be one, two people, max, assigned as the dedicated overlords to check messages, respond to comments, and post to the platform with a unified style and message. Social media can't be an afterthought. It has to be a dedicated, prioritized part of your campaign, of your strategic plan, really. And number seven, use images. They are necessary. 90% of the information processed by the brain is visual, and it takes only 13 milliseconds for the human brain to process an image. And that 13 milliseconds is 60,000 times faster than the way people can process text. Tweets with images receive 150% more retweets than tweets without them. And on Facebook, photos have an interaction rate of 87%, meaning people will engage with them, compared to 4% if there aren't any pictures. The images have spoken loud and clear. So next, I'm going to talk about where we can find some of those images that you can use to engage your audience. But before we go there, we're at the halfway point. Did we want to get into breakout rooms to talk about this stuff, or should I keep plowing on?
So I would say everybody just maybe drop it in the chat, whether you'd like a chance to go in small groups and talk with your colleagues, or if you want to hear more from Carina right now. It looks like in general, everyone wants you to keep going. Please continue. Oh, somebody said, do stories count as images? For your...
Well, I mean, obviously if someone isn't a seeing person, then yes, of course, you would have to have that visual. But I think as people who work in librarianship, stereotypically, we tend to like to read. And we tend to be the kinds of people.
Do you mean, sorry, I can't, I lost who it was that said that. Do you mean stories like Instagram stories? Like,
oh, you mean video? I think
they're thinking like, you know, when you do the, yes,
oh, absolutely.
It's just stories. Yes.
Oh, absolutely. It doesn't have to be still images. It can be the kind of beauty that moves. That's totally fine.
Okay. So in general, everyone would like to hear more from you, Carina, before we chat. And then Mary also has a question. Are we going to talk about using videos? Do you mean on social media specifically, Mary? Yes. Are we going to talk about video, social media videos? That is also its own.
No, but that, yeah, I could do a different presentation just on videos and video editing and video construction, because that's something that I've also done professionally and I love to do. But no, sorry, not enough time in this one.
Okay.
All right. We'll so keep we're gonna going then.
Keep plugging along.
All right. So let's talk about online tools. There are a lot of them out there. These are my personal favorites and the ones I use the most. While I was creating the presentation, I kept thinking of more and more online tools that I would love to share. But since we only have so much time together today, I put all of those additional ones that I'm not even going to talk about in this presentation in the resources at the back so that you can find them and play with them. Today, we are going to talk about Pixabay, Nappy, Remove BG, which stands for background, Canva, Google Slides, Eyedropper, and TinEye. Pixabay. Pixabay is a free online repository of images that you can, and I quote directly from their website, copy, modify, distribute, and use even for commercial purposes, all without asking for permission or giving credits to the artist. Now I get it, we work in librarianship. Accreditation is a thing. However, if we credited every picture that we used in the design, it wouldn't look very good. Attribute when you can and where it's appropriate to do so, but it's great that there are tools out there that don't require that attribution. And since we had a question about videos, that also goes for videos too, it's really easy to put the attribution as a thing at the end of the video. And you could technically do that with your slides too. If that was something that was important to you, you can have an accreditation slide. Nappy. Another place I love to get my images is Nappy. Nappy specializes in beautiful photos of Black and brown people doing normal day-to-day things. It is still frustratingly hard to find good photography of Black and Indigenous people of color. This site is a great resource, and it also allows you to, and I quote, download, modify, share, and distribute for free. The site considers it their mission because, and I quote, the more you use them, the more they're helping improve the representation of Black and brown people in the media. And the quality of the images are really top-notch. Remove BG. BG stands for background. Transparent backgrounds are a beautiful thing and vital to my design work. I probably use Remove BG every day, probably a few times a day. To get rid of the background of something. So I can layer it nicely onto something else and make something new out of it. It's free, it's easy. The link is in the resources. You just upload a picture and it does a pretty good job of erasing the background. It's not perfect. If you know how to use Photoshop, you know how to use that magic wand and you can get into the nitty gritty and erase pixels one by one and start, you know, playing with the sliders. Yeah, you can do a better job with that, but I am impressed with how well Remove BG works, I have to say. Canva, a lot of people's favorites. And it's one of those tools where if you can afford it, pay for it, especially for institutions. It's one of those tools where it makes everyone look like they really know what they're doing, even if they don't. It comes with templates, stock photography, built-in tools for editing graphics, also has a resizing tool, and this is for the pro version. So you can make a design once and resize it for all your social media needs. That is huge. Sometimes I have to make 11 different versions of a design because I have to make the Instagram version and the Twitter version, and then the YouTube cover is ginormously huge. So you can make the design once, they have a little resize feature, and it'll actually change the dimensions of everything. It's not perfect. If you go from something that's really landscape oriented to the square of Instagram, things might have to be reshifted, but it's already there in a new file for you to manipulate. Super helpful. And this is another tool I probably use every day. Love Canva. All right, Google Slides. Most of us are probably familiar with Google Slides. I'm using it right now. But did you know you can change the size of the slides? This was a game changer for me. The default, when you go to make a PowerPoint on Google, Google Slides, is 960 pixels by 540, which is a great aspect ratio for computer screens and Zoom presentations because it's the right shape, but it's not so large that it would slow a computer down to be able to look at it. But if you think of Google Slides as not just PowerPoint and think of it as a canvas instead, you can really have some fun. You can use Google Slides to make square Instagram ads, super huge YouTube heads, more standard Facebook post and event sizes, or any space you need to fill in a website. So if the slider on your website, or you have a half page, or maybe there's an ad in a newspaper that you need to fill, you can do all that with Google Slides. And this is obviously truly free. The signs in this slide are ones that I've created for different social media or newsletter headings. So the speculative fiction one, that's the header of our registration form, which is also Google Forms. Then we have a couple of Facebook, I think we have a Facebook post, a Facebook event, and then the middle is an Instagram one. So the way I do it is I create the 1080 by 1080 Instagram Google slide file. And then everything that goes in there are all for Instagram size ones. Oh, and the way to do that, file, page setup, custom. And then you can put in by pixels or inches. So you could also do 8.5 by 11 if you want to do those printable posters from your library. We're going to return to Eyedropper for a second because we're going to look at it from a different angle. And we're going to talk about why color is important. So it states your brand, it can set the tone of a piece, and can make the difference between something being accessible or not. Eyedropper, like I said, is a free Chrome extension that allows you to hover over a section, and then you can see the hexadecimal, and then you can use it in your design choices. But again, another plug for Eyedropper because it is that important and that useful. All right, TinEye. TinEye is a reverse image search. What that means is you can upload any image, and you can also, you can see there's a paste or enter image URL, so you can even connect it to an image that you don't personally have downloaded but is available online. And it's useful for several reasons. You can use it to track down the usage rights of an image and figure out where it came from. So just because you find an image on a site that says it's free, sometimes it's good to double check and make sure. We understand when you just have that feeling that something is not legit and you want to kind of dig a little more to find out. I did that actually for this presentation. The front picture that I have with the light bulb, I just wanted to make sure that it was free and open. So I did a TinEye on it, and there were like 10 pages of versions of this image. And I was able to go back to the earliest one. I was able to see different versions, different colors. There was one that had gears in the light bulb, one that had words in the light bulb. People take them and change them and re-release them. So it's a great way to sort of hunt down the source. And TinEye gives me the option to shop around for that a bit. Another great thing with TinEye is that after you find the images, you can then sort them by size. So if you find an image, like say we found that little poodle, And we want the bigger one so that we don't have to stretch it out and pixelate it. You can pop that picture into TinEye, sort by biggest image. It's literally called biggest image. And you can get the biggest version of that. It might not be available in a bigger image, but sometimes you get lucky and you can get a nice, good quality photo for your design needs. All right, let's talk a little bit about networking in regards to marketing. So what I mean about networking is, how do you connect with your community and other organizations? Most of the advice that is out there on networking tends to be for businesses that sell products, which is not us, or nonprofits, which don't really fit us either. Here are some methods that I found useful for libraries, institutions, those kinds of things. Schools. And this is a message for public libraries. Schools. Most of you probably already do this. Having a great relationship with your local schools can give you a service pipeline to your community. Explore with your schools to see if there's even a way to share resources, maybe even make mini consortia. I know this is hard. I was a K-12 school library media specialist for 6 years. Their jobs are incredibly structured. And depending if it's public or private and what the union situation is, doing anything after school or on the weekends may not be appropriate. But it's worth it to navigate around that K-12 schedule, to hear from your teachers, your school library media specialists, and your school administrators. They have insights as to what our kids need day in and day out that we sometimes just don't get to see. And I get it. Not every school worker is open to that kind of collaboration. I have been there where you try and try and try and they don't answer you and it's just not going to work. But if you haven't given it a try yet, I recommend it. And don't just keep that to K-12. Seek out your community colleges, your universities, your adult schools. Beautiful opportunities exist there as well. You don't realize until you reach out how many other organizations are struggling to do the exact same things you are doing. Trying to serve people and market those services, but they're having trouble reaching people. So with your forces combined, you can do some pretty cool things. Which brings us to assisted living communities, also called senior centers, retirement communities, 55 plus, continuing care. They have many different names with different purposes, but the core is that they serve older adults. So that's a targeted patronage. And they have regular programming and marketing needs just like we do. And they serve the same community. So this is another great opportunity for collaborative programming. Every public library I've worked with has had a good relationship with their senior centers. And sometimes they'll have, for example, book clubs, and maybe you'll go there and deliver the book club, because online isn't always a good match for senior centers. But give them a call. You'll be surprised. They might be delighted. Chambers of Commerce. These are a great way to connect with your business community. Some chambers of commerce are local or municipal, and some of them are countywide. It's worth it to have a library representative on your chamber of commerce meetings. Sometimes you have to pay for membership. Sometimes the chambers of commerce are usually okay waiving the membership fee once they understand that you are not there for handouts. You're not there to get something from them. You're trying to figure out how to give things to them. You want to find out what they need so that you can give it to them and improve your services. Once they wrap their minds about that, they're usually very excited to have you there, because you're like a wish list. They just keep giving you ideas and you hopefully can keep making them happen. And when you have a good rapport with your business community, it can create a conduit of mutually beneficial programs. So you'll find businesses that are, you know, small, starting out, they maybe have educational components to them, and they're looking for an audience. They're looking for a way to spread their message, to talk to people about stuff. And you are in a position with a platform and you want to provide programs to people. It's a perfect relationship. And they tend to be very thankful, very forthright, and they tend to be free, especially if they're new and they want to get, you know, up off the ground. So now let's talk about local organizations. Every town has local organizations that I can't even name because they're specific to those communities. There are Lego clubs, 4-H, Rotaries, book clubs, religious organizations. People gather. And wherever they gather around an interest, there's an opportunity for connection and collaboration. The new program you're trying to get off the ground might already have an established group in your community. Go find them. They're usually delighted to work with libraries because we can expand their group so we can get them more members, but then we get to put it on our programming list and serve our communities better. So again, great relationship. Let's talk about fairs and festivals. Until I got into the scene of fairs and festivals, I had no idea how many happen every weekend. It is another world once you figure it out. Each event can connect you with thousands of people in your community. The way it works is some organization is hosting an event where people have the opportunity to buy tables. I put that in quotes because some of them may let you do it for free. And that means that you have that space, that is your space, your table. Sometimes it's 10 by 10, sometimes it's just a 6-foot table. Sometimes it's free, sometimes it's not. You then have that spot for the duration of the event to talk to people about whatever you want. You can share services, provide kids crafts, do library card signups, do mobile checkout if you have the ability to do that. This gets your library out and into part of the community. And a side benefit is you also get to meet local businesses who are also vending at the same event. You get to meet food trucks and you get to meet crafters and artists. Look for county fairs, arts and crafts festivals, food truck events, career days, and job fairs. These all have great opportunities for you to have a table there. And then finally, LinkedIn. LinkedIn is not just for connecting with your patrons, but it's also a useful way to connect with other libraries. So this is good about networking with other libraries so you can see how they're doing their marketing stuff and you can steal, AKA learn, how to do something better. Learn what your sibling institutions are doing. Get together online and talk shop. Creating an organizational profile on LinkedIn also provides another way to connect with businesses. So you might not find that business at that local fair, but they might also have a LinkedIn profile and you might find out you're right next to each other and beautiful things can happen. So I just threw a lot of stuff at you. This image makes me laugh because if you go onto Pixabay and you type in librarian, this is the first image that comes up. And it kind of looks like me, which makes me smile. So now it's your turn. Are there any challenges that I didn't cover or some brainstorming you would like to do? Is there any ideas that you would like to share with everybody, not just me, so that we can grow our knowledge? And if there are any general questions, I am here. Here's the resource list as promised, full of things I covered and things that I didn't. And you'll all be able to have access to these slides. And I'll just leave this up. This is my contact information again. And thank you for spending time with me and let's chat.
Yeah, everybody feel free to unmute at this point and let us know suggestions you have or problems that you're running into or things that we can kind of chat about as a group and have a conversation and figure out. So Kyle from Ocean City said, very informative, but he has to leave. So thank you, Carina. Anybody have anything that you want to chat about or share?
I have a question and a share. So when I became a director, I followed all the libraries in New Jersey on our Facebook page and our Twitter page. And it gives you so many good ideas of what to do and ideas that people need this class for. So it's super helpful to see what other libraries are doing too. The other question I have is we were using Hootsuite and they want us to pay to use it now. So I didn't know, can IFT, that I'm saying it right, do what Hootsuite does, Carina?
IFT won't schedule.
Okay.
it'll just do it instantaneously. And also the beauty of Hootsuite is that it lets you change the images so that they line up appropriately. IFTTT won't do that, unfortunately.
Got it. Okay.
But you can also, I believe Zoho is an alternative to Hootsuite that you can use.
Zoho. Okay. All right. I'll check
Zoho out. Social. Yeah.
Yeah. So, and also, where do you get ideas for like contests and things like that to engage with people? Do you just look around? Is that what you mostly do?
Google search.
Got it. Okay.
Yeah. You just poke around and see what other people are doing.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
We have a question in the chat that says, social media question. I can't seem to get my audience to respond to me, no matter what I post. Any advice?
Depending on how long you've been doing it, maybe it's not the right platform. That could be a possibility. I don't know what demographic you're specifically trying to reach, but maybe it's time to switch platforms. Maybe it's time to try a different tone if you were using a very formal tone. Maybe you want to use a casual one. Are there pictures of you on your social media? I know that librarians stereotypically are shy people who do not like to be on camera, but a smile, a person, a face is so very important. And even if you have this really huge organization and you don't want to be seen as a face, that face goes a long way. They know they're talking to a person instead of a void of a company. But if you've done all these things and it still doesn't work, it might not work. Social media is not a guarantee. You might want to switch platforms, try something else.
And there's another question in the chat that says, what's the best way to Facebook post visually? With a PDF upload or create it somewhere else and then size it? I'm not sure what the Facebook sizes are.
Okay, so not a PDF, definitely not a PDF. You want to go for a JPEG. If you have something that has transparencies, you'd have to do a PNG. But generally, you want to go for a JPEG because it tends to be a smaller file size. So if somebody's looking at this from a very old computer, they would still be able to see it and it would load no problem. The Facebook sizes, I don't have them memorized. I think the event is 1920 by 1080. And then I forget what the post is, but they are different. They're not the same.
I don't know if it's on the free version of Canva, we have the paid version. But I do know that if you go into Canva, even if you don't want to use it to create your image, the templates have like the different sizes. So you can pick like Facebook cover, Facebook event, Facebook, whatever, and it will give you, you can just pick a blank template and at least that will give you the size. Does anybody who have the free version, does it offer that?
No, it's only for the paid version.
It's only for the paid version.
Okay. Yeah, but you can very simply do a quick Google search. What is the size of a Facebook post? It'll tell you 512 by 630 or whatever it is. You can go to Google Slides. You can go and change the size of your slides to that. And then you've already got your perfect canvas that you can play in to get the right size.
Jonathan says images sizes are available on the free version. So
we won't resize for you. So you can customize it and you can make it that size, but if you already have a design and you say, okay, now I want to make it for Instagram, that's in the paid version.
Okay.
Sorry, I didn't make that clear.
And you guys can feel free to unmute. I mean, this is it's a skill sharing conversation. So feel free to unmute and ask your questions and give each other answers in chat.
I want to put in a plug for Angela Hirsch's library marketing. Does anybody know about that? She does great tips, great ideas, great resources, and you can sign up. She gives the information on all the social media sites. I mean, she distributes information on all social media sites, and she's really great. I put her, I put some information in chat.
Awesome, thanks. Yeah, I didn't know about her, cool.
Can I ask, we have a sort of large Facebook following and Instagram, and we're sort of, the whole library is coming back to life with more programming, and we're particularly trying to get programming information out, but we don't have a lot of engagement, so, and we've been making a lot of posts, like sharing other libraries' ideas of, oh, do you know it's National Insert the Thing Here Day, that kind of thing, So our thoughts are to sort of quiet down on sharing other people's posts for a while and then to restart posting to sort of get the attention in the algorithm. Do you have any other ideas about trying to, you know, if you have a following, trying to build that engagement after sort of a lull?
You're doing exactly right in focusing back on yourself again. Can you hear me? I'm not highlighted. Oh, there we go. Okay. Also making, so for, I don't know if this was just an example, but you had said, did you know it's so-and-so, it's national whatever day. Try and avoid questions that are yes or no. Try and go for questions that require a conversation. So if it is national whatever day, say, post a picture of you doing national whatever day. And then you can turn it into a contest. You can turn it into a poll.
Or to create it somewhere else inside of it. I'm not sure what the phrase is.
Also, showing the changes that they make is really impactful. So if you say, we're doing a new bulletin board design, what do you want on there? And then showing it in a story, how you're building it and you're actually doing it. It takes a lot of time. It's time consuming stuff, but that's sort of the stuff that works. So you're doing everything that I would think of going in the right direction.
Does anybody have a tool that Carina didn't mention that you find to be really helpful?
I'll share real quick. We use a photo service called Affinity Photo. We moved from Photoshop to that. And that's why I was asking about Canva, because it's a paid subscription and you pay for one user per subscription. And it's so similar to Photoshop. It's just so much easier to use, download updates, and it's not, everything's not cloud, but it's just a much easier for the way our library system is set up to use. And that's what I was curious about Canva. If I pay for a version of Canva, am I paying for one license for one user, or can I pay for a version and then people can just download it and use it? Do you know how that works?
Are you asking me for the legal answer? Illegal. So you're supposed to have a license for each individual person, and you can create teams, which is nice, these sort of organizational teams. So your, you know, children's librarians and your adult librarians can have their own separate pockets so that their designs aren't all crawling on top of each other. Technically though, who you decide to share your login and password is up to you. So
because it is web, Canva is web-based, it's not a download, like, so they don't need to download it to their device. So like Carina said, would it work forever? Technically, you just need one login.
Yeah.
Technically.
What she said.
I have a question.
Oh, go ahead.
Oh, sorry. Thank you. It's maybe more of an opinionated question. I often try to use a not necessarily completely professional, but kind of like a warm tone while I'm communicating on social media. But I wanted to ask whether you think, I want to ask the level of professionalism that you think we can use on social media. Like, could it be very like text and friendly and like, oh, we're BFFs kind of thing, like how companies tend to respond to people who respond to them? Or do you think we should lean more towards like a slightly professional but slightly friendly tone? Like, what would your opinion be on which one's better to use when we're talking on social media in terms of libraries and organizations like that?
I think it's exactly how you would deal with your patrons. So you might have a patron that, I mean, you know that there's a line that you can't cross. There are certain things you can't say. There are certain things that just make it awkward and weird and too friendly. But there's a patron who might start very formal and you're like, okay, that's the tone. All right, we'll dance. We'll stay formal. And then there's others that are really casual. And then by the end, you know, you find out you both love to knit and you're complimenting each other's clothing and you both take your kids to the same daycare center and you start talking. So yes, it's okay to totally go informal if the conversation leads there, as long as you always know where that there's not that line and that everything you say is public. So if you are talking one-on-one with a patron, it's private. You can maybe make some jokes. You can maybe use some slang that you wouldn't use in public. But if you know that every single thing you say is going to be public and permanent, I don't care about privacy settings. Privacy settings change and screenshots can make everything permanent. So you have to always make sure that in every interaction you are representing your company and kind of librarianship as a whole. So, which I know is a heavy burden to think of. But as long as you keep that in mind and it's friendly and fun and nobody can misconstrue it, there's no way that somebody can read that and be offended or consider it off color or, you know, taking things a little too far. Have fun. Make people laugh. Be a friend. Be a community member.
Thank you. I'm also curious along those lines if anybody's library has multiple social media channels for different audiences. Because I live in Cherry Hill and I know our public library here has like a Cherry Hill Instagram just for the teens that comes out from the YA librarians. And that is a lot more, you know, the jokes and the references and the emojis and the TikTok videos and stuff obviously are very different from sort of the official Cherry Hill Public Library Instagram page, which is a lot more, like Ashley said, formal. So is anybody doing that in their libraries with kind of multiple accounts? No, just curious. It seems like a lot of work because then you have to have like multiple teams.
And even if you're not, I like I said before, ideally pie in the sky, you don't say the exact same things on all of your social media accounts. Since the demographic for Facebook tends to be older, people tend to use Facebook a little more formally than they would for Instagram. Doesn't mean you have to, but it's one way that you can approach it. So it's okay to say, okay, our Twitter is going to be like this, and our Facebook is going to be like this, and our Instagram is going to be like this, and stick with those tones. Or like I said, if you're busy, I get it. Connect them all and then have it all copy the same place if that's what you have to do to get through the day.
Admittedly, that's what we're doing at LibraryLink right now. Our Facebook and our Twitter and our Instagram, all our LinkedIn, they all post the same thing because we just don't have the time right now. But I think you're right, Carina. Ideally, they would all contain different content so people are not seeing the same thing every time they come across us.
I see that comment from Jonathan.
Yeah.
So here's what I would do for that, if this helps to give you a little more structure and direction. Make the post more formal and the comments more informal. So use the post as an announcement, sort of, the kind of thing that the consortium members, your sponsors, are going to be fine with. And then the nitty-gritty comments, replying back and forth with people, that's a really great time to get more informal. And again, if you know your board members, consortial members, whatever, are watching, give them a shout out. It's always a great idea to acknowledge your sponsors. I call them sponsors, but you know what I mean. Your stakeholders, make sure acknowledging them, it'll make them like social media more. Rachel says that at Ocean County, they have 4 social media platforms, but when they host a program, they choose which are suited for the particular audience. Exactly right. That's exactly what you should do. Every single thing you do doesn't have to go on social media. That's another thing. You don't want to have it overburdened, and you don't want to... So for example, you may or may not be using the events feature on Facebook. Some people don't like to do it because people think that if they respond to the Facebook event, it means that they're in and it doesn't count towards the registration that you need for the numbers on your site. So some people like to turn it off. But if you do use it, it can make it show that you're really busy. You can also tweak Facebook events now so that if somebody clicks registration, it can go directly to your site. So that is a feature that they have now that you can tweak. But yeah, you might not want to put every single book club, especially if the same people come every time. It's okay to not post constantly.
We have about 5 minutes left, and I'm curious whether anyone has had success, big successes with any other kind of marketing strategy besides social media. I know social media is like the big one that we all, you know, we're all trying to get really good at it, but is there anything people have been using that they found like, wow, this really gets the word out there?
Angela Hurst really suggests targeted emails. And I'm finding that by looking at people who attended a music program, I send them a note saying this program is coming up. And some of them sign up for that program. But she's a big believer in that.
And is that very time consuming for you to have to kind of go back and look at who registered for what? And
you bet it is.
Yeah.
but I try. I mean, and people use, you know, apparently you can do that with creative, with what do you call it that everybody uses? You know, every single person uses it to send out Constant Contact. I don't have access to that. So I just do Excel spreadsheets. And it's really fun when people say, you know, take my name off a list, and you have to make sure to take it off of every single list. And what I've learned is if something comes back and it says address unknown, I used to go back and try and figure that out. I don't bother anymore. Let them just send me back the note that says, you know, it didn't go through. I don't care anymore. We also have a twice monthly email newsletter, but I have no say in what goes out in that. And it's frustrating because some of the program descriptions are off, some of the titles are off, some, you know, the images are off, all kinds of things. But with my little email list, and I'm sure it's a pain for some people, and I have gotten taken off the list for some, but overall, nobody's complaining. Knock on wood. Of course, today I'll get 20 complaints.
Yeah, I mean, there's MailChimp, there's Constant Contact, there's One Contact. There's a lot of programs out there that do that kind of thing. They tend to only stay free for so many users. You can get around that by having multiple accounts. It's more to juggle, but it is possible. It's also, you can also send stuff from like a Gmail account, and then in your contacts, keep the metadata of who is in what club. As far as distribution lists. But if you don't have an event management software, which I highly recommend, but they are very expensive for good reason because they do a lot of this work for you, then yeah, it's a lot of work. You're muted.
I just use Excel. And also you don't forget the human error factor, which is huge. I do the best I can.
That's all you can do.
Somebody just wrote in chat something interesting, which I was curious about, Rachel.
Mm, yeah, outreach to groups presenting. So that also works together with the businesses. So you sometimes they'll let you come into their businesses and you can sign up their whole organizations for library cards and things like that. Yeah. Outreach is a whole nother presentation.
Well, we have just about a minute left. Is there anything pressing that anyone wants to ask or share before we go?
Happy Thanksgiving.
You too. So what will happen is once we're done here today or tomorrow, I'll send out a follow-up email with Carina's slides because it has all the resources and links and everything in it. Thank you so much, Carina, for curating that for us. And it will also contain a little survey with some feedback that we would love to have from you. And just as a reminder, if there's any other topics you want to see for these conversations, or if you have a skill that you want to share, we would love to hear it. So reach out to me and let me know. And with that, I'm going to end our recording and say goodbye to everyone and have a great holiday. And thank you so much to Carina.
Thank you, everybody.